Hawaii 1970, BS Electrical Engineering, Air Force Institute of Technology 1982, MS in Physics from the University of New Mexico 1989, Michael's done graduate work in Egyptology, both, how do you pronounce those? Oh, Free University, yeah, okay. Free State, Berlin, and Johns Hopkins University. And Michael's a member of the Board of Trustees of the Foundation for Ancient Research and Moral Studies at BYU, has held permission, or is part of BYU, and has held positions as Associate Lecturer of Ancient Scriptures and Instructor of Ancient Scripture. He also taught at the United States Air Force Academy as Assistant Professor of Physics, and served as Director of the United States Air Force Academy Observatory. And his publications include The Four Book of Breathings, and The Translation and Commentary, which provides a translation research on one of the many fragments of Joseph Papyri, and a farm paper told Joseph. I'm going to quit at this because it's going to be too complicated. With that, I'll turn the time over to Michael Rhodes.
Make sure I'm heard here. Okay. What I'm going to be talking about is a response to the recent video, The Lost Book of Mormon, Investigating a Remarkable Mormon Claim, and my evaluation of the basic flaws in the scholarship in that. This was a video that was produced in 2002 by the Institute for Religious Research at Grand Rapids, Michigan. This is the same group that back in 1985 published the book on Joseph Smith Papyri by his own hands, upon papyrus, Charles Larson's book. All right, let's jump into it. Some observations. It's interesting that critics of the Book of Abraham very rarely, if ever, deal with the text itself. They deal with the perceived method by which it was produced and try to prove it false on that basis rather than looking at the text itself. And that's certainly what happens here. In only one tiny instance at all do they even talk about the text itself in this book. This video. The text of Joseph Smith's prophetic calling ought to be the book itself. By their fruits shall ye know them, it says in Matthew. Not the methodology he used in producing that text, which we in detail don't know anyway. So that's just an observation to begin with here. The basic argument put forward by this DVD and by that previous book ever since the papyri fragments became available is that the Book of Breathings papyrus that forms part of these papyri is the papyrus that Joseph Smith used in translating the Book of Abraham. Scholars now translated this book. It is a Book of Breathings. It is the Book of Abraham. Moreover, it can be reliably dated to around the 2nd century BC, nearly 2,000 years after Abraham. Ergo, Joseph Smith was a false prophet. Well, let's look at the flaws in that reasoning. I'm taking each of these arguments step by step. The Book of Breathings Papyrus that the church now owns is the actual document that Joseph Smith had. And the reason they say that is because, first and foremost, facsimile number one is part of it. It certainly is part of the collection of papyri that Joseph Smith had. And here we have that particular portion that from which facsimile number one was taken, and it's beyond any shadow of doubt that that's exactly what it is. Obviously, portions are missing and were filled in by the engraver, but it's obvious that this is the actual facsimile. And it does form the beginning of the Book of Breathings. You can match up the papyri fragments quite nicely, and there's no doubt that this forms the beginning of the Book of Breathings. The name of the author of the Book of Breathings is in the hieroglyphic text to the right of the facsimile, and that name is also found in the hieratic text of the Book of Breathings. The video claims that some of the Kirkland Egyptian papers are the actual documents that Joseph Smith used in the translation process. This is on the basis of the fact that you have passages from the Book of Abraham and hieroglyphic characters that come that are demonstrably from the Book of Breathings there. Problem with that is, as Hugh Nibley has and others have definitely shown, is that the English text was written in first in a different ink, and that the characters were copied afterwards. In many cases, the characters actually overlap the original English text. So what we have here is not the process of translation, but clearly someone trying to match up Joseph Smith's translation with some characters on the papyri. It seems to be the unsuccessful attempt of some of the brethren to figure out how Joseph Smith did what he did, so that it's not the translation process at all. All right, we've translated the text. My most recent book is a translation and commentary of that text. It doesn't mention Abraham. There's no Book of Abraham in there. How do we reconcile that with the fact that facsimile 1 is right there at the beginning of it? And in fact, facsimile 3, although we don't have the original of that, is demonstrably would have come at the end of the text of the Book of Breathings. Reading went fast there. I'll catch up, no problem at all. I'm still too far ahead. Yes, there we go. Indeed, the fragments we do have contain no mention of Abraham, but they're only fragments, and that's a key point here. We only have a tiny bit of all of the papyri that Joseph Smith had. And, you know, we can come up with percentages if we want. The key point is we only have fragments. Of the actual Book of Breathings, there are probably 40 to 50% of the total text of the Book of Breathings found on the papyri. Whether there were other texts on the papyri, we don't know, because we don't have all of the papyrus. And there's no reason why a copy of the Book of Abraham couldn't have been on there. To say that there couldn't have been is simply an argument from silence and not good scholarship. In the video of Robert Ridner, who's a professor of Egyptology at Chicago, maintains that it is totally unprecedented to find two different texts on an Egyptian papyrus like that. There are, in fact, numerous examples of just that. Probably the one that's of greatest similarity here is that Papyrus Fongier, which has a Book of the Dead, an Egyptian religious text like the Book of Breathings, on one side, and a tale on the other about a man who was sacrificed. Remarkable parallels with the Book of Abraham. So there are, in fact, examples of ancient Egyptian papyri with multiple texts on it. We simply don't know what's on the rest of the papyrus. All right, how about the fact that it can be reliably dated to the 2nd century BC rather than 2000 BC, the assumed date of Abraham? They make a big deal about the fact that in the introduction there it says, written by his own hand upon papyrus. That's simply indicating the authorship of the original book. I can take a copy of Harry Potter and say, this was written by whatever her name is, I don't know what it is. Rowling's, there we go. That doesn't mean she wrote that one that I'm holding in my hand. It's simply a copy of an original text. All this says is was originally authored by Abraham, and what we have is a copy, not the original one penned by him previously. All right, translation is another important term we need to define here. Joseph Smith used that term in a somewhat broader sense than we do today. The term that comes closest to what we think of as a translation is a translation of the Book of Mormon, where he had an ancient text in front of him and translated it into a modern language, English. He did a little bit differently with the Urim and Thummim rather than a knowledge of the grammar and the textbook and dictionary and so on, but that comes closest to our concept of translation. The translation of the Bible proceeded totally differently. He simply had a text of the King James Version of the Bible in front of him, and through direct revelation obtained divine commentary and corrections and additions to that text in English without ever seeing the original documents. In D&C's section 7 is another example of a translation. Here is a translation of an ancient parchment done by John that Joseph Smith clearly did not have direct access to, but via revelation obtained a translation into modern English. So what kind of translation was the Book of Abraham? Which of those three does it fit into? Well, two possibilities occur to me. The middle possibility is just not possible because he didn't have an English translation of the Book of Abraham, which had been corrected. So the first and the third are the two possible. A translation of an ancient text, just like the Book of Mormon, or a translation by direct revelation, like the parchment of John. Let's look at each of those. This seems to be supported, the idea of translation from an ancient text, by references in the diary of Joseph Smith to translating ancient Egyptian records, and statements of some of his associates. And it is undeniably possible that a copy of the ancient Book of Abraham could have been somewhere on that papyrus. So, to me, that's the most likely explanation. But I don't eliminate the possibility of the second one, although it doesn't feel as good to me. The idea that the Egyptian papyri simply stimulated Joseph Smith thinking about Joseph in Egypt and Abraham, and thus received by direct revelation. If you adopt that stance, then you have to assume that the statements in Abraham 1, 12, and 14 referring to the illustrations are parenthetical remarks by Joseph Smith inserted into the actual text of Abraham. Either way, it works, but I prefer the first, and that's my own belief at this point. All right, that brings us to what I call the facsimiles problem. Facsimiles 1 and 3 that are now associated in the Book of Abraham with the Book of Abraham are the beginning and ending of the text of the Book of Breathings on this particular papyrus. Facsimile number 2 was totally elsewhere, had no relationship even with the Book of Breathings, but was a separate document. Why are they associated with this ancient pagan text when somehow there's a relationship with Abraham? The answer to me is simply that these illustrations ultimately derive through a 2,000-year period from illustrations done by Abraham, but have in that intervening period been adopted and adapted for other uses. What Joseph Smith simply did was to give the original interpretation of the illustrations as they had been done by Abraham, although they're in a very distorted form as they appear now. All right, key to that is there evidence then that anciently these illustrations were associated with Abraham? That's the real pivotal question. And the answer is yes, and this is really, to me, the bulk of the evidence that supports Joseph Smith's association of these things with the Book of Abraham. Let's start with facsimile number 1. An ancient Egyptian papyrus dating roughly to the 1st or 2nd century AD, so within a few hundred years of the Joseph Smith papyri, has a lion cow scene similar to that we find in the Book of Abraham. Let's look at that. And underneath there, in the circled portion, is the name Abraham. And it says, Abraham, who upon, Hoepi, it's in Greek. And then the papyrus, as you can see, breaks off. The key point here is that an ancient Egyptian papyrus that Joseph Smith didn't know about associates this scene with Abraham. Let's put the two side by side. They're inverted there. And note there are some similarities and there's some differences. First of all, the person is not actually lying on the lion couch, right? They're on another bier, that's B-I-E-R, not E-E-R, behind the standing figure. But the general similarity is obvious, and again, the association with the name Abraham is pivotal. All right, let's turn to facsimile two. On your left is the church historian's a copy in the church historian's office of the facsimile number two, illustrating that apparently, at least when that drawing was made, that there was a considerable amount of damage. And in fact, the areas that are shown damaged are have text that has been taken from other papyri and placed into the drawing, which don't belong there, and are upside down, and problems with it. So that helps to understand some of the seeming incongruities with the facsimile drawing as we now have it. All right, in an ancient Egyptian papyrus of roughly the 1st or 2nd century AD again, there is a phrase, Abraham, the pupil of the eye of the Wedjot. The Wedjot was the special eye of Osiris. Osiris was killed by his brother, chopped into pieces and thrown all over the earth. His wife's sister, Isis, gathered them all together and couldn't find the other eye. And so that eye was miraculously restored, and then he was resurrected. And so the eye, the Wedjot eye, the perfect whole eye, was symbolic of resurrection in eternal life. And there it says that Abraham was that Wedjot eye. In the 162nd chapter of the Book of the Dead, contains the instructions for the making of what facsimile number two is, a hypocephalus. It indicates that, it talks about the wedge of eye and then says that that represents an eye. It is a pupil, is what it is. And that's one of the representations. And so here we have Abraham called the Wedjot eye, and the text that talks about making hydrocephali associated with Abraham. In a pseudepigraphical text, texts are ancient texts that are of religious content that never made it into the Bible for various reasons, some of them fairly obvious when you look at the Gospel of Thomas, for example. At the end, Peter comes up to Christ and says, are women going to be in the celestial kingdom, pointing at Mary? And he says, don't worry, Peter, their sex is going to be changed, and we'll all be men, and everything will work out. Fairly obvious why that one didn't make it into the canon. But they clearly have some ancient roots that go back to traditions associated with the people that they claim to be talking about. Well, there's an ancient status. Come on, pseudepigraphical, oops. There we go. In this apocalypse of Abraham, Abraham sees a vision. And in this vision, he describes what is in the heavens, on the earth, in the sea, and in the lower depths. In facsimile number two, these words are found, O mighty God, Lord of heaven and earth, and of the nether world and his great waters. Very similar terminology. So we're finding even wording in these ancient texts associated with Abraham that are similar to wording found on this particular hypocephalus. Continuing on in this apocalypse of Abraham, Abraham sees the fullness of the universe with its circles in all. He sees a picture of creation with two sides. That is the hypocephalus. For the Egyptians, besides being the eye, it was the world, that which the sun encompassed. As you look at it, there's an upper and a lower portion. The lower portion is inverted to the upper. That's the upper and lower portions. This is a a description in this book about purporting to come from Abraham of Hypocephalus, where he's seeing the creation portrayed, if you will, in this manner. Abraham sees what are clearly the four figures labeled number six, in facsimile number two. He describes that the head of, you know, these four beasts, with one with the head of a man, one with the head of the hawk, one with the head of a jackal, and so on, that are the same as those that are portrayed there in facsimile two. He sees, and again, where it's quoted, this is a direct translation from the original, the host of stars and the orders they were commanded to carry out, and the elements of the earth obeying them. That resonates with the language we find in Abraham 4, verses 1, 12, 18, 21, and 25, where it talks about the elements of the earth obeying. So we're finding even the same language being used in this ancient text that purports to come from Abraham and the book of Abraham. And again, the association with the Hypocephalus, that facsimile too. Abraham, in this document, is also promised the priesthood, and that this priesthood would continue in his posterity, an element of the Abrahamic covenant that is totally missing in the Bible, but is central to the book of Abraham. And that promise is associated with the temple. Interesting again. All right, let's turn to facsimile 3. Again, facsimile 3, we don't have the original of, that clearly belongs with the Book of Breathings. The name of the owner of that papyrus 4 is found there. And as it now stands, it is a portrayal of the man Hor, who is the... with the god Anubis, who leads the dead, standing behind him, and the goddess of truth, identified by the feather on her head, leading him into the presence of the god Osiris, whose wife Isis is standing behind him, and he has passed the judgment and is worthy to enter into the presence of God, and in fact become one of the gods. That's the essence of what that scene portrays from the Book of Reading standpoint. All right, the Testament of Abraham, another ancient pseudepigraphical text, describes Abraham seeing a vision of the last judgment. And in this vision of the last judgment, he sees an angel with scales weighing the hearts of men, or weighing the souls of men. Scholars all agree that this is clearly a reference to the 125th chapter of the Book of the Dead. The guy must have had this in his before his eyes as he was describing this. This is an admixture, if you will, of Christian doctrine with ancient Egyptian concepts of the judgment of the dead. One of the Joseph Smith papyri fragments is, in fact, this 125th chapter. I'll show you that in a moment. Facsimile 3 portrays simply the next step in that process after the weighing of the soul, or the heart, in the case of the Egyptians, you're brought into the presence of Osiris. So let's look at some illustrations. This, you're probably not going to see it all. This is horrible. This is an indication of the state of preservation of these papyri, but the god Osiris is seated there, and the scales are down below, and a young lady is being brought into the presence of Osiris by the goddess of truth, and her name is Neferirnu. This is one tiny fragment of a Book of the Dead that is among the Joseph Smith papyri. Right, here is that actual scene from a better preserved Egyptian papyrus. Here we have the man Hunefer is being brought by the god Anubis. Before the scales, his heart is being weighed against a feather, which has beautiful symbology in Egyptian, because your heart is at the center of your thoughts and your desires, and the feather is the Egyptian hieroglyph for truth and justice. And so you have to balance with truth and justice. The god Thoth, with the ibis head, is recording the results of that, and if you pass, then you're introduced into the presence of Osiris, and that's the scene on your right that forms basically the similar scene that is facsimile number three. The animal standing underneath the scales there with the head of a crocodile, the front body of a leopard, and the rear body of a hippopotamus is a monster that if your heart doesn't balance, he gobbles your heart up, and then you're cast into outer darkness where there's mud and snakes and sewage, and it's I think it is a good personification of outer darkness. All right, what I've done here is reverse the mirrored the Hunefer papyrus so that it matches up the same direction as the Joseph Smith one, and you can see that it's simply portraying that final scene of that total judgment scene, and hence just such a scene in the Apocalypse of Abraham is, the Testament of Abraham is being described. Okay, the point. Several ancient Near Eastern documents associate the scenes that we understand as being facsimile 1, 2, and 3 with Abraham. And they're roughly contemporary with the Book of Abraham papyri. Secondly, none of these documents were available at the time of Joseph Smith. He couldn't have somehow, snuck into the library in Palmyra and seen these and come up with this, or in Kirkland or wherever. I mean, they weren't available anywhere in the world. He couldn't have known about them. You can't dismiss this as just lucky guessing. I mean, you guess one, when I give exams, I give a lot of multiple choice, and if the students don't know, they don't do well on the exam, right? You flip a coin and one out of four, you're not going to do well on an exam. Joseph Smith hit the nail on the head three times with these representations being associated with Abraham anciently. How can that be just lucky guessing? I mean, if so, he's the best guesser in the world. We never listen to him anyway. All right, at the end of this video, Richard Mew, I don't know how to pronounce his name, Mao, okay, he's a Mao Mao. Okay, he's a head of a seminary in California, Fuller Seminary in California. He says, are the doctrines taught in the Book of Abraham credible? Are they the sort of things we should bet our life on? And, with the implicit answer, heck no, because of all of this mountain of evidence that they've shown us that it's not true. Well, yes, they are. They're certainly worth betting our life on. The Book of Abraham contains some of the most beautiful and poignant doctrines of the Restoration, the pre-existence, our eternal nature as human beings, that the council in heaven, much better portrayal of the creation. There's beautiful and wonderful doctrine there. We might respond, do we want to bet our eternal lives on the opinions of scholars? I think that would be an apt question, and I would wonder what their response would be. Let me close with this statement from Hugh Nibley, which I think sums up nicely what I've been trying to put across here. The words of the prophets cannot be held to the tentative and defective test that men have devised for them. Science, philosophy, and common sense all have their right to their day in court. But the last word does not lie with them. Every time men in their wisdom have come forth with the last word, other words have promptly followed. The last word is a testimony of the gospel that comes only by direct revelation. Our Father in heaven speaks it, and if it were in perfect agreement with the science of today, it would surely be out of line with the science of tomorrow. You might say scholarship, too. Let us not, therefore, seek to hold God to the learned opinions of the moment when He speaks the language of eternity. Thank you.
Since I have control of the mic here, I want to make a comment. I just got your book, Traditions of the Early Life of Abraham, and when you open to the back, there's an index of unique elements in the Book of Abraham.
That's not my book. But
no,
that's Brian Howard.
That's Brian Howard. Okay.
That's right next to my book. This is great.
It's right there. Okay. Questions? Go to questions. No questions. Pardon? Oh, sorry.
It seems part of what we're learning here is that we have to be open to different worldviews and the way that symbols may have been interpreted at different times. And I was interested by what you just mentioned parenthetically about the Gospel of Thomas, that dialogue at the end. And my thought was, because we've had preceding lectures about, it's not just biological, it's inheritance, that possibly could that text be related to when saying women become men, is that they would have the inheritance and have them have related to those blessings.
I suppose you could interpret it that way, in a symbolic way, but it certainly strikes against our belief in the eternal nature of that gender.
There's apparently a concept in looking at the Egyptian writings of layers of meaning, particularly when you look at something like the hypocephals, that you can interpret at one level and another level, and even maybe a third level. Could you comment on that?
Well, I guess, first of all, by levels, I don't know that I would call it levels. I would simply say that Egyptian symbols have multiple ways of being interpreted, but not necessarily multiple levels. Like, there's deeper levels or higher levels. It's simply one thing can mean, let's take, for example, the lotus flower. The lotus flower can be symbolic of eternal life. It can be symbolic of health. It can be symbolic of truth. So there's multiple meanings, but I don't think that there's the idea of multiple levels where you see kind of an outer level and then sink down deeper into a deeper level that you didn't catch before. That's not, to my understanding, typical of Egyptian documents at all.
A lot of people can probably answer this in the room, but what was their source on the Hinnibli quote?
That's World of the Prophets is where that's found.
Facsimile number one as being a part of the front of the Book of Readings, is it also not possible that a second facsimile one on a Book of Abraham scroll could have been there? There could be two where the one is extensively damaged and the other one was not.
The drawing matches up so perfectly that I don't think there is any question that the facsimile number one that we have in Pearl of Great Price came from the surviving portion of the papyrus. I can't imagine that another one would have matched up so perfectly that it just happened to be one from Abraham. No, I don't think so.
I have heard that somewhere a year or two ago that some of you were working on the matter of the astronomical depictions in facsimile number two and in the third chapter, and that those were more representative of the Egyptian view of things, and that therefore this was then a support for the inspiration given to Joseph, where Joseph might have tried to put in some modern astronomy or something, whereas this was a typical Egyptian view. Would you care to comment on that?
Actually, I don't espouse that view. My colleague John Dee does think that the view portrayed in Abraham 3 is ancient Helios, geocentric. There we go. I'm only an astronomer. I don't know all those fancy words. a geocentric point of view. In a paper I gave a couple of years ago, and which will be published soon, I adopt a view that it in fact portrays a more modern point of view. So, and I almost suspect that it's possible to look at it from both points of view to some extent. But to me, it more clearly portrays a modern point of view than an ancient one.
How modern?
Well, modern to the extent that it sees other stars as simply suns like our own, that there's multiple planets, the universe, that the Earth certainly isn't the center of the universe. It's rather just one of a myriad of planets and stars that are part of God's creation. You know, look at the latest Hubble Space Telescope and the galaxies and whatnot. To me, that's the kind of thing that's portrayed.
Thank you very much.